Moin. I'm really happy to see so many faces. I'm really happy that I've been invited here to give a talk about sustainable digitalization. And I must say I'm very happy to see first time my slides. And I have definitely not to worry about the font size of my in my presentation. Wow, it's quite impressive to see it in on such a large scale. My name is Stefan Kreuer. I'm physicist. At least that's what I started at university. But I'm working in the, let's say, wider IT world since more than 20 years. I started in the software development, but today I'm more focusing on concepts, on strategy, and as a scientist also dealing as an independent scientist also dealing with the topic of sustainable digitalization. I'm organized in the Scientists for Future organization, and I have taken the logo of the Scientists for Future right here. Scientists for Future is an organization which was established beginning this year together with the activities of the Fridays for Futures, which you know. And at some point, scientists which are alerting since more than 30, 40 years about climate change felt very happy that the young people are going on strike to really to push this topic to the public. And then some politics were coming and saying, oh, but these are kids, they have no idea, they are stupid. Climate change is much too complex for them. Let's not listen to them when they are going on strike on Friday on the street. And then many scientists became very angry and said, no, sorry. That's exactly what we are telling you since 30, 40 years. And now please listen to these young people and please listen to the science. And so the organization of Scientists for Future was established, and with 27,000 scientists in Germany, Switzerland and Austria supporting this. But what we also are doing, we have also decided that we as scientists have to go more out of our ivory tower and really telling to the people what are the facts we have in science and where are the problems we have with climate change. And it's maybe a little bit surprising for you, maybe not for all of you, but for some of you, maybe that we are also coming here to tell you something about climate change related to maybe your daily job. What I want to tell you is a bit, so I have to manage it not to go outside of the camera view, but at the same time not to be before my presentation. Well, I want to tell you something about digitalization and sustainability, which is a kind of ambivalent relation. I will tell you why. How digitalization is contributing to climate change, that's the topic. And then looking on why and what can we do to overcome this situation. And this is related to so-called rebound effect and sufficiency. And yes, what are the solutions? I just to manage your expectations, I will not tell you the magic recipe how we can really change this. We are still at a point where we have some ideas for approaches, but not really the magic solution yet. So just very shortly, a few words about sustainability. I have made the experience in the past that I was always convinced that talking about sustainability, that everybody knows what I'm talking about. But then I have learned, and especially in this area of IT business, that some people, when they are talking about sustainability, they have something completely different in mind. They are talking about sustainable business and these kind of things. No, I'm talking, when I'm talking about sustainability, I'm taking care about the future of society, the future of this planet. That's what we have in mind when we are talking about sustainability. And the first definition was coming from the Brundtland Report in 1987, was from the United Nations. It was the first time that a kind of definition was put in place, what we have in mind when we are talking about sustainability. Means it's a kind of contract between the generations, that this generation and is not over-consuming something which brings future generations into risk. To be a little bit more in detail about sustainability and about sustainable development goals, it's something which is also have been defined by the United Nations 2016. They defined 17 sustainable development goals, and here, just not to mix it up here, when we are talking here about development, it's not software development, it's the development of society, of the planet, of our future. And you can see we have many different topics. It's also many topics about our about people, about our society, no poverty, zero hunger, health, education, and there's also number 13 here, climate action, so that we also have to take care for our climate, and several other ecological topics as well, of course. And the ambivalent situation with digitalization is that here we are in a situation that in all these 17 development goals, sustainable development goals, digitalization has can make a positive impact. We can find, I will not go into details in this stuff, it's not the object of my talk, but I could tell you for each of these 17 sustainable development goals, I could present you some solutions, digitalization solutions, which really bring a positive impact to it. So digitalization can also bring really some very positive things to the world. No doubt about this. And just to give you very, very few examples, just to show that digitalization can not only bring positive impact, digitalization for us, even when we are looking to the climate change situation, digitalization for us is mandatory to overcome the problems we have today. Digitalization is really mandatory to find more efficient, better ways to tackle certain things. You all know, okay, video conferencing, to avoid that people are flying around. You can, city infrastructure can become very more efficient with smart solutions. Mobility solutions, energy supplies. Here, it's in with the smart grids. It's really, really key that we are able to change from the current energy situation to renewable energy, and we will definitely not be able to do this without digitalization. So, digitalization is not bad, let's say, but and this is the big but there is a problem behind. And I want to start with just few figures, key figures, just to give you an idea of what I want to talk about with you. Let's start with this one, 3% of global greenhouse gas emissions. 3% of global greenhouse gas emissions are coming from the IT business. This is exactly, more or less exactly, in the same order of magnitude as the whole global air transport industry. The air transport industry, which is very much under pressure in the media, in the public discussion, because they are also spending 3%, roughly. 10% of the global electric power consumption is spent by IT business, by data centers, by internet infrastructure, by electric laptops, tablets, mobile phones, and so on. So here we are in the range of 10%. So that's not nothing. That's really something serious. And this is, let's say, a kind of status quo. That's the is situation from with some figures from 2018. We have on top, and this is really the issue behind, the real issue, we have a 9% increase, a yearly increase in the direct energy footprint. Means 9% every year means every 8 years it's doubling. These figures are from 2018, so we can expect that in 2026 we are already consuming in the IT world the double amount of what you can see here. That's really scary. And just another little figure, just to give you an impression, 2.5 kilogram of CO2 are produced by every gigabyte of data which is transferred via the internet. It's we have to be a little bit careful with this figure. It's the error in this figure is could be quite big. So it's rather an order of magnitude. I don't want to say it's really 2.5. It could be also 3. It could be maybe 2. But it gives an impression of what we are talking about. To give you another impression of what we are talking about, here's some figures from a study which has been performed by some scientists in Sweden in 2015. In 2015, they made some, they measured very in detail where we are, where this energy in the IT world is spent, and they made some forecasts also for the future 2030. And the big one, the big chart you can see here is what they have taken into account in their IDs as the expected case scenario. And the expected case scenario, everything is growing exponentially and going up to, in 2013, up to about 8,000 terawatt hours per year. Just to give you an idea, what does it mean, 8,000 terawatt hours per year? The whole world, the globe, on the whole global world, we spent today, this year, 2018, we have spent about 22,000 terawatt hours per year in 2018. So means 8,000 would be somewhere in the range of more than one third of what the whole world is spending on power consumption. That's the expected scenario. There are some other scenarios. Best case scenario, very optimistic. And to be honest, there are no indications that we could be optimistic. But nevertheless, they made also some best case scenarios where we only end up in 2013 with 2,500 terawatt hours per year. And also a worst case scenario where we end up with, in 2013, with 30,000 terawatt hours per year, which is much more than the whole world is spending currently, only for digitalization, for IT business. Why? What is the problem? Why we are able with digitalization to make more efficient solutions? Digitalization is really the way to automate things, to make it more efficient, really to make savings. But at the end, we are spending more and more and more energy on it. So what is the reason behind? And the reason is well known since ages. It's a so-called rebound effect. And here we're not talking about basketball. Rebound, just to raise this question, how many of you have heard about the rebound effect? So there are already several who have heard about it. When you're dealing with sustainability, this is a very famous effect. rebound. What is the rebound effect? I have to explain. And to explain, I go a little bit away from the digital world, go back to the analog world, because it's easy to explain in this area. Here I have a comparison of two cars. You only know them, I guess. One car from 1915, shortly after Second World War, and another car from 2010. It's a Golf 6, it's not the newest one, so not the Golf 7, but, and here it was a Käfer, a Volkswagen 1100. What do they have in common? They have in common that at that time both cars were the most sold cars in Germany. So means they are in a way representative, let's say, for the most popular cars in Germany. And both, not exactly the same, but quite close, there is some improvement, yes, but fuel consumption for this car was 7.5 liters per 100 kilometer. Fuel consumption for this car is 6.5 liters per 100 kilometer. It's an improvement, yes, but wow, not really, not a big improvement for, let's say, for 60 years engineering, hard engineering on making the engine more efficient, making the improving the fuel consumption. And in between, we had all these discussions about the 3-liter car, the 1-liter car even. No, we are still here in the same range of fuel consumption than 1950. Are our engineers stupid? Have they not developed something? Have they not invented more efficient engines? No, of course, there are 60 years of engineering inside, and yes, it has changed dramatically. Yeah? The maximum velocity has changed dramatically. The power has changed dramatically. The weight has also changed. And we have more comfort, we have more security, safety on board. We have more fun driving with such a car than with this car. It has changed a lot, but not in the saving of fuel consumption, not in saving of energy. For the energy, nothing has changed. Means all the efficiency, all the improvement in efficiency was going back in more, more, more. More fun, more safety, more comfort, more velocity, and so on. And that's exactly the rebound effect. We are able to make savings, we are able to make things more efficient, yes, and in digitalization as well, yes. But at the end, we are spending all what we are gaining on one hand side, we are spending on something else, instead of just being happy that we have made some savings. You probably all know the Moore's law, that the processors are becoming better and better, and this is a logarithmic scale, so this is really an exponential growth, that our processors are becoming faster and faster and faster. So yes, it's again, here we are talking about an efficiency improvement. Our CPUs are becoming better and better, more efficient on the same space, with the same energy consumption. We are able to have more processor power every 1.5 years. It's doubling. So even if it's maybe not completely true in our days today, but it was at least true for a long time. So we have the same situation. It's becoming better and better, more efficient, but it's not leading to that we are saving energy or something like this. No, it's leading to growth. We are doing more and more and more. And just, or maybe I'm going back to this, just to, and not to show you how old I am, but just because I find it's quite funny. This is the first operating system I have worked with personally. It's MS-DOS 2.11 from 1983 on a so-called floppy disk, maybe Most of you have never seen this. maximum capacity 720 kilobytes. This was the whole operating system. Windows 10 today is on a hard disk is 10 to 20 gigabytes what you need to install it. So it's you would need for Windows 10, you would need 14,000 of these floppy disks. Just to install an operating system, which is okay, and not very fair, but at the end, the operating system is doing today still the same job as in 1980. It's a level which is to ensure that the machine is running. Okay, not very fair. I know that Windows 10 is doing much more than this, but okay. Nevertheless, it's still the operating system. 14,000 floppy disks today to install it. So this is again the rebound effect. So that what we are gaining here in making efficiency improvement, we are spending on 10 gigabyte operating system. And I can tell you, because here is the logarithmic scale. When I started in the IT world, it was somewhere here, in mid 90. So we have today 20, 25 years since when I entered in the IT business, and in this time the processor have improved by a factor of 1,000. And when I was end of the 90s, when I looked into the offices, what people were doing, and they spent already a lot of time on emails. It was not at the end of this of the 90s that people spent a lot of time on emails, and sometimes a little bit Word and Excel and And today, I'm looking to the offices. What are people doing? They spend a lot of time on emails, maybe a little bit Word, a little bit Excel. They're doing still the same job, but with a machine in front, which is 1,000 times faster. So that's a very, very classical rebound effect. We are not able really to benefit from the savings, from the more efficient solutions we have, because we are reinvesting in graphical, user-friendly interfaces, doing this and that, and fancy things. Okay, there's also security and also all this kind of stuff, but that's the reality. And here that's when we are looking to internet traffic, which is growing, Cisco data, with also some forecast for the future, hardly exponential growth here. Everything is growing. And you can look in all the IT world, in different charts, everywhere you will find exponential growth, Internet traffic as well. That's the reality. How can we overcome this? The key word when scientists are talking about it, the key word is always sufficiency. Sufficiency, so being sufficient or looking for sufficient solution means we have to find a way to find the right balance. That's what scientists are always telling you. So we should spend only as much digitalization as necessary, but as little as possible, and not just doing what is possible and wasting it finally. Maybe not looking so much cat videos or something like this. We should be more sufficient in this area. Sufficient in the technology, in the use, and but also in the data. Today we are doing the opposite. We are spending on data in the cloud without thinking about it. It's copied. It's existing two times, three times. We don't take care for this. But nevertheless, sufficiency is something. First of all, it's something a little bit theoretically theoretical, I would say, but what we really would like is also to come to more concrete solutions, really to see what can we really do. Okay, sufficiency. Let's be sufficient. But what can we really do? And what I have in mind is that we need the following five points, and I will explain them a little bit more in detail. Let's start with awareness. Awareness is, and that's exactly what I'm doing here. Awareness. We have recognized that there's not a lot of awareness about the problem in digitalization. There is awareness about problems with digitalization in the privacy area. Yes, for sure, people are afraid or scared about artificial intelligence. Yes, all this is there, but nobody is really scared about the power consumption of digitalization. So we need more awareness. We need more awareness when people are dealing with this kind of topic that there is an issue behind. This is not really well known today. This is not in the media, not really. So awareness is the first point for us, and it's also a point where you could help. Of course, it's really need to spread the word. We really need multiplier who are bringing this knowledge into also the coding society, let's say. But there are some more points. Renewable energies. Renewable energies is maybe not something which is fully in the hands of software developers, but to some extent maybe even software developers can influence decisions on hosting and so on. Here just to give you an impression of the data centers, and of course data centers are one of the biggest power consumers, that we have with different companies. This is from a Greenpeace Click and Clean report, 2017, 2018 is not yet existing. I have at least not received it yet. And you can see that different companies have a different percentage of different energy sources, and here on the left side, the green one, this is renewable energy, and some companies are probably already doing not perfect, but better than others, and especially when you're looking to our very popular Amazon Web Services, Amazon is one of the not so good ones. Let's be clear about this. I'm not able here to give you the magic recipe. Just some ideas, and one idea is okay. There is already a very great website, the greenwebfoundation.org, where you can easily look if your website is hosted, if a website you are looking on internet, if a website is hosted on a more green or less green, let's say, hosting solution. And in Germany, I'm not paid by these guys, but I really can recommend them to small hosting solutions, BioHost, DE, and host sharing. So if you have the chance to influence it in a way, please have a look for more sustainable hosting solutions, working with more renewable energy. From HTTP archive, some data about internet pages, and here I would like to talk about resource efficiency. This is the average size of a web page on internet since 2011 till today, more or less, and we end up with about 2 megabytes today for average size of a web page. So again, increasing. Of course, there's a lot. One of the major reason behind, of course, is images and videos, of course. But you can also find, and here I'm maybe coming a little bit closer to software development. If you take, for instance, WordPress, you all know WordPress as the number one content management system. And you install WordPress with a standard template, then it looks very okay. Hello world. So this is not very fancy, but that's what you will have if you install WordPress. Hello World, just Hello World, no graphics, no images, nothing. Data weight 272 kilobytes, just for Hello World. And if you are really looking into it, and if you analyze carefully what is transferred, the data which are transferred, especially in the JavaScript and the style sheet area, then you will recognize 76% of the data which are transferred from the hosting solution to the end user, to the browser of the end user, 76% are not used. They are simply not used. They are somewhere in the libraries, in the style sheets, in the JavaScript libraries. They are transferred in case of the web page needs this stuff, but at the end they are not used. And this is something you can really find, especially when you're dealing with such kind of standard solutions, you can find it everywhere. And just to show you one example, this is already quite famous in the world of sustainable development, from a British developer, Jack Lennox, who have really managed to bring this Word template. Who's Hello World? It looks a little bit different, but okay. At the end, it's the same. He was able to bring it down to 6 kilobyte. So this is what I'm talking about, or what I have in mind when I'm talking about resource efficiency. This is not resource efficiency. And this is producing power. You need power to transfer this data. And this is producing CO2, bringing it to the climate change for nothing. 76% for nothing, for really nothing. There's not even any benefit from it. Except for the developer or for somebody who is setting up a website, it's in the time to market approach. Of course, it's much easier than if you have to go this way of Jet Linux to analyze really in detail and optimizing it. Of course, this, I'm pretty sure he spent a lot of time on it to do it. So time is almost over, so I just quickly jump on the two other aspects, but very shortly. The other aspect is reduce the obsolescence. Obsolescence, and I have, sorry for, this is from a German book, just to make you aware that the hardware here, this is for a Samsung Galaxy smartphone here, this is for Apple iPhones, for two different types. Most of the energy in the life cycle of a smartphone, but it's the same for a tablet and also to some extent for tablets and so on, laptops, most of the energy is spent before the device is arriving at the customer, at the end user. In the pre-production means you have to the mining of the minerals and metals you need in the production and really in the distribution. So most of the energy is spent here. So that's why it's so bad, let's say, if we buy every 2 years a new mobile. Because it's not the energy we are consuming which is the problem, it's the energy which is in the device. And coming back to the obsolescence topic, there is hardware obsolescence, yes, for sure. We all know that the repairability of these devices is not as good as it should be. But there is also an issue with software obsolescence, and you probably know it all, that after a while, a mobile phone or a tablet cannot be used really because the operating system is not supporting anymore these old hardware. The apps cannot be updated because the operating system is not updated to the newest version. And then very quickly, as an end user, you are in the situation that that the hardware is still fine, but you cannot make use of it anymore because all the relevant apps are not running on it anymore. So this is software obsolescence, means within software we have also to become more careful that we ensure that it's also running on older devices, just to overcome this cycle that people have to buy every 2 years a new device, which at the end is produce a lot of energy. And a very final slide, just to very shortly to make you aware, and I have put out just few pictures here. Improve transparency and create incentives. Today the situation is that the end user, the consumer, is fully not aware about what happens. When I'm using my mobile phone, I'm surfing on the internet, I'm looking to Netflix series or something like this, the energy I'm spending is not that big. The energy which is spent at the same time in a data center or in the internet infrastructure is huge. But the end user, the consumer, is not aware of it. He doesn't see it. So we also think that we need, these are just some examples, that we need a kind of classification and kind of labels, something which is really bringing the awareness to the consumer about the energy consumption. I have not the solution yet, to be honest. Here, this is an example from a French project. They developed a little Firefox plug-in, carbonalizer called, just a first approach, let's say, to bring this information closer to the consumer, that with surfing on the internet there is really some energy consumption and finally CO2 emission related. And so this would be the first step, the transparency, and the second step, of course, once the consumer is aware of it, there must be also some incentives, let's say, to bring the consumer in the right direction, that he cares about what he is doing. And you know all that there are these discussions about CO2 taxes, which could be a way, not easy, to be honest, because most of the energy is spent outside of my country normally. But to be very, very clear, what is really bad, let's say, are flat rates. Flat rates are really, let's say, a kind of opposite of CO2 taxes. CO2 taxes is the idea behind is really to bring it into the responsibility of the consumers, that how much he's spending. Flat rates are doing the opposite. Flat rates are giving the responsibility away from the consumer, because he's just paying a certain amount. It's always the same amount, independently of the consumption. So, sorry to say, because I also feel very comfortable with flat rates, but at the end, flat rates are really part of the problem. And that's where I would like to end. I overspent already a little bit the time, and I have to say thank you.